Joining me now is Professor Eitan Gilboa, an expert on U.S. relations at Bar-Ilan University, who is keeping up with the growing international pressure, including from the Biden White House, to extend humanitarian pauses, perhaps, if not use the word ceasefire, put a temporary pause on the fighting itself. Professor, thanks so much for being with me. Talk to me about the pressure. Clearly, there's a lot of pressure. Netanyahu last night saying that even if we have to stand alone, we will continue to fight until victory. Is there real, tangible, concrete pressure that the U.S. is exerting on the Netanyahu government, or are they still letting the Netanyahu government give a free hand to complete the mission at hand?
Neither nor. There is some pressure about minimizing the killing of civilians, and much pressure on increasing humanitarian assistance. Israel is saying that humanitarian assistance is okay, but leaders of the West must also demand humanitarian gestures from Hamas. Yeah, I'm not hearing at all from European leaders saying to Hamas what they say to Israel. They say to Israel, you have to abide by international law, but I have not heard them saying the same thing to Hamas. Is it possible that evil terrorist organizations are exempt from international law, from legal rules that govern law? If I were the head of the International Red Cross, I would call for a press conference every day and say, Hamas, you are violating international law. You are required to give us access to hostages. And that way to apply pressure on Hamas. We don't know what are the Hamas's demands for the releasing of hostages. We know what it wants, and what it wants is a ceasefire so it could regroup and undermine the Israeli military momentum running after them at the Shifa Hospital headquarters.
Professor, we are 1 year away from the U.S. presidential election, the key election. We have massive anti-Israel protests across the United States. We have pro-Palestinian marches and demonstrations at college campuses across from coast to coast in America. They're exerting pressure on lawmakers against Israel, against the Israeli actions. What pressure do you think that the U.S. government is feeling from these protests? And is there shock, is there surprise at the anger, the hatred of Israel, despite the legality and the justice of Israel's mission?
Yes, I think I was not surprised, because I'm teaching in the United States every year. I've seen these processes of dehumanization, delegitimization of Israel, the occupation of universities in the United States. Columbia University has become an occupied Palestinian territory. They do what they want. They decide who will teach, what to teach, where to teach. This is absurd. But now we see how all of these things are exploding. In terms of pressure, yes, there is a lot of time until the presidential elections. So far, I think that these demonstrations are not influencing American attitudes toward Israel and the war. I would also say that public opinion surveys in the United States taken recently show that the American public is with Israel, not with the demonstrators. They shout much, but there's not public support for their slogans, especially the one that has been now clarified: from the river to the sea, Palestine will be free. I heard Rashida Tlaib saying, oh, this is, we only want human rights in the entire area from the River Jordan to the Mediterranean Sea. This is bullshit, because it says Palestine will be free, which means the elimination of Israel. So I think that there are all kinds of psychological warfare inside the United States and in the Middle East. There are some people who say that Biden's strong support for Israel will be translated into additional voting for him, especially among Jews and supporters of Israel in the United States.
Hmm. Professor, thanks so much for being with us and for your analysis of the situation. Great to have you.
Thank you.